Hey everyone, this is Cyber Defenders, and we have ProxyLogon, a difficult threat hunting lab by Cyber Defenders. So let's read the scenario while the lab initiates. In late February of 2021, a threat actor known as HAFNIUM exploited a new vulnerability in Microsoft Exchange, which is known as ProxyLogon, with a CVE ID of 2021-26855. As a SOC analyst in an enterprise utilizing GrayLog as the SIEM solution, your responsibility is to conduct a thorough investigation within the company's network to ensure the absence of any malicious activities. Your objective is to proactively hunt for potential threats and mitigate any risks that may compromise the network's security. Let's begin with question number one. What tool did the attacker use to identify services running on the victim's machine? The first thing I did for this question was to filter the logs by file beat. This could potentially show any logs coming from an IDS. And as we predicted, we indeed observed some Sorikita logs. And as we scroll down, we notice Sorikita rule signatures. A common rule is the emerging threats, or ET for short. We could continue inspecting these logs manually, but I prefer to filter for any scanning activity using the relevant Sorikita rule. In our case, we are using the emerging threats rule set, which includes a rule for scanning activity labeled as ETScan. Upon reviewing the results, it is evident that nmap is used to perform a port scan. Therefore, we should submit nmap as our flag. Question 2. What is the browser that the user spoofed to exploit the vulnerability? We can use information from the nmap scan alert to get the IP of the attacker. Filtering packets with this IP can help us to determine the user agent information, which includes the browser as well. To start, we will filter by packet beat, as we are currently dealing with network traffic. We will also add a filter for the attacker's IP address. And finally, we will use the filters sidebar to get the top values for the user agent. Then we can see the browser and its version in the first result, which is our flag. Question 3 says, what is the local file path of the shell dropped by the exploit? The lab seems to be nudging us toward investigating the network, which suggests a strong possibility that the exploit was delivered via HTTP requests. To confirm this, I checked the top values for the request content type, which can sometimes reveal a wealth of information. We can observe that the top content type was URL encoded values. I also inspected the logs that had the content type using the show document for this value option. And then added the URL path to the columns to view the URL encoded payload of each request. However, these results indicated some sort of communication between the attacker and a web shell installed in the host. We could also see the URL of the web shell that was dropped. However, we are only interested in its actual local path, not the URL. So, we need to dig deeper. My next step was to check the application/JSON content type. I viewed the logs for this content type, and knowing that these were JSON requests, I added a column for the request body content. Immediately, I identified the complete local path for the web shell, which is our flag. Question 4. what is the post request parameter used to execute commands on the server? Going back to the URL encoded requests, we notice many requests that execute commands using the data parameter, which is our flag. Question 5 says, what is the web shell used by the attacker as a backdoor? Going through the web shell requests starting from the first request, we can see the entire command history of the attack. I copied them and went over to CyberChef to decode the URL encoding. Then I went over to my text editor and did some cleaning to make the commands more readable. Going through the commands, the third command appears to download ASPX spy from a GitHub repo, which seems to be the name of the web shell used in the attack. I confirmed this by visiting the source code for the web shell. Question 6. What is the MITRE ID of the technique used by the attacker to gain persistence? Going through the commands again, we can see the attacker trying to create a domain account on the target system. This could be a persistence mechanism. So, we head to the MITRE matrix and check the persistence methods involving account creation. We immediately see three sub-techniques, with the second sub-technique ID, which involves domain account creation, should be our flag. Question 7 says, the attacker tried to evade defenses by renaming the web shell. What is the name of the web shell file after rename? Going through the commands, we can see the web shell being first downloaded as out.aspx, and then later renamed to log.aspx, which should be our flag. Question 8. What is the name of the service the attacker tried to enable on the victim's machine? We can also see within the commands executed a command that tries to interact with the WinRM service. Making it our flag. Question 9. The attacker injected a shellcode in the memory to gain a reverse shell. What is the MD5 hash of the shellcode? The last command executed on the system seems to be doing a bunch of stuff, so I just copied it over to ChatGPT and asked it to explain and clean the code, since it appears to be obfuscated. The results weren't bad. I could understand that it has some base64 data that contains the second stage of the attack, so I focused on uncovering the contents of this second phase. I copied the base64 data over to CyberChef and started cleaning it. I began by replacing the format string placeholders. It seems to replace placeholder 0 with the equal sign, and placeholder 1 with the number 8. Then I noticed we had a lot of escaped Unicode bytes, so I unescaped them. Lastly, I removed the plus characters that concatenate the payload, so we have a single blob of base64 encoded data. Upon decoding this blob, CyberChef detected that it was a gzip file. So I used the gunzip recipe, and we can see the second stage of the payload. Assuming I don't know what this stage does, let's head over to ChatGPT and dissect this second stage further. In summary, the script seems to be decoding shellcode from a base64 blob. It will then load and execute the shellcode into a freshly mapped memory region. Knowing this, I went over to CyberChef and decoded the base64 blob containing our shellcode and calculated its MD5 hash, revealing our flag. Question 10. What is the file name of the tool used by the attacker to move through the network? This question was a bit of a rabbit hole for me. I couldn't find any reference to a tool in the command logs beside procdump. It turns out that I had missed a very important detail while doing my investigation. We saw the attacker using a GitHub repo for downloading most of his executables. So it makes sense that we check this repo. So, by heading to that repo, we can see psexec64.exe, which is our flag. Question 11 says, the attacker used two methods to access credentials on the victim's machine. What is the MITRE ID of the second method used by the attacker? Using some OSINT and the fact that we know the attack came from the HAFNIUM group, as mentioned in the lab scenario, I went to the MITRE page. There, I found the two credential dumping techniques. The first is LSAS, which we had already discovered, and the second is using NTDS. To confirm this, I went over to the logs and searched for ntds.dit. And I saw a lot of activity, which likely confirms our suspicions. With this, we have completed the last question in the lab. So, thanks for watching.